This morning, we're Thank you. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to be able to do it. I'm not going to I know that we live in an amazing country, and we are this is that as the world gets darker, the light's supposed to get brighter, okay? But if we have to go get the revival back, because we haven't seen the light of the world, I'm not sure what light the world has seen. And so we can look around at the world, and I've got some reports of things that are going on in the world, this city and this city. Thank you. we know already in the first verse, Paul has authority as the author of this book that brings direction to the church and to the church. To the saints who are the Ephesus and faithful Christ teachers, grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. Just as if you are calling in your Bible, I didn't come in here, but now I'm going to go to the next. Just as he, God, Jesus, chose him, the Father chose Jesus before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the blood. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, which he made to abound toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he proposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together one in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on the earth, in him. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him, who works all things according to the counsel of his will, that we, who first trusted in Christ, should be to the praise of his glory. In him you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. Expectation to reach a city, which is totally to be your way. He did it all. I'm going to tell you for a minute about Ephesus. You can go read all about it, you only can give me like a book. In the first century of Ephesus, this city was the only to be grown and vibrant church. Well, I tell you, in which context they were born in the Bible. Think about this. John was the pastor. Paul was there for 2.5 years of pastor of the church. Yet, in that realm, they were supposed to worship the gods of the empire. They were supposed to worship all the gods of even their city. They had all these different things in the church. The church in Ephesus was walking down the streets. And as they walked down the streets, they were required to do things toward the gods of that area. And then you read about the gods of the world. And then read about the world. Now, let's say the belief that the church had is described. John is believing Jesus as the resurrected Savior, offended the most loyal people to Rome. He would offend them so much that they actually get thrown into an oven off of the coast about 50 miles from Bethlehem. They removed the pastor. And they shoved them off 50 miles away on an island, thinking this is going to stop this. And so, when we think about all of the nuances of what I just described, and you can read about it, but all the things that I just described, this church is writing to this church that is thriving in the midst of persecution. So what was rich soil, all that stuff, it all happened there. And there was this interesting thing that you had to do if you wanted to enter this place, the Agora. You had to burn incense to enter on good terms. And so think about this. The place where all commerce happened, it didn't happen on the ground. Like, this is the place where everything happened in the city. But when you entered the gates of the Agora, you had to give incense and burn to the God. And so the church in that region, we know they're thriving. We know they're doing well. But they were excluded from the things that gave life to the city. You can only go to any grocery store. You can only go to any shopping place in this area. When you walk in, you burn incense to the God of heaven. Some public pastor named for Jesus, Timothy Pastor, telling someone that we know was the main God. What were they teaching? What were they ministering to a church who was excluded from the world? Yet, we find out later in the reason they didn't have to the world. What were they teaching? So this marketplace, and I'm going to say this, I'm going this place where they were, it could be that this in our day and age is not just a marketplace, I mean, it's a marketplace of ideas, in which, as a believer, we have hope. All the things of their lives revolved around worshiping these gods. Part of this was the that worship the God of fertility with debauchery and craziness was thriving and growing. And we can look outside the walls of our church this morning and we can say, what market kind of find is this coming? We can look outside this video, we can talk about crazy stuff that's happening. But I want to draw you back to the first part of this book, the one where it says that it was Israel. It was in the beginning all the time. It was all of his plan and purpose. It was a city that was affluent. They had pretty much everything that they could have ever wanted in that city. And yet, a pagan city completely was walking with the world and a church that was on fire. And the incense where they burned the incense, there were people there that would actually watch to make sure you did it. And there were people in the church that were so tempted that someone actually went and did it just so they could be a part of something. You see, our call is not to be a part of the world in what they worship. Our call is to be worshiping the one. And if they cost us a lot of details that we don't even want to talk about this morning, but I'm telling you, this church is thriving. And we know that when you turn to your Revelation 2, we know that because John goes to the Isle of Patmos. Jesus encounters him. He begins to write these messages to the churches, and the first one that he wrote was to Ephesus. And I want to read this to you because I believe it is relevant to us today. I'm starting Revelation 1:1, but the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants things which must surely take place, is sent. Signified by the angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ to all things that he saw. Blessed I look around, I
taken out every sickness, every pain, every disease. He's already taken care of it. He had all these things. He's listed all of your works. Thank you. Thank you for all your works. But the motivation of your heart is wrong, and in this hour, the motivation of the heart is the only thing that matters. So what are you going to do? Repent and do the first works. Or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from this place. Unless you repent. So say, listen, you haven't made us number, you haven't made me number one. You built things that are not going to last because I wasn't involved in it, but I'm glad that you've been faithful. Today is the day of repentance, which means to turn away and not go back, right? To turn away from those things, and maybe they're good, but to turn away from the good and the bad to focus on them. First of all, put this in your mouth. That you hate the deeds of the way of things, which I also hate, but to put it as death. Thank God, I'm going to and love that my spirit is changed, but my body really doesn't have that same something. My body really doesn't have it. So they actually engaged in all the sexual stuff, but they were still part of the church. And they were like, listen, you know, our spirit is right, but our body really doesn't have it. So we're going to go live the life that we want to live, and we're going to go back to the church, and we're going to be unholy. And Jesus said, I know. If you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate, there's coming a moment, and I'm telling you, it's weird what it's called. It's called a weird thing, where the heart of the matter and the holiness of the church is going to be all we have. And so my call to you this morning is you need to repent. Today is the day to repent. If you have to repent about the good things you've done that Jesus smiled on in your place, and it wasn't in the right frame of focus, then repent daily. If you're doing things that you know you shouldn't be doing, but you still come to church and put your hands up and worship Him, but yet your body is failing because you're doing things that you shouldn't be doing, then repent for that. But this church that was in revival, He didn't come in and just bless them. He came in and said, listen, there's a higher call to the church in this hour. There's a higher call to the church. If in this crazy world in which you live in Ephesus, there's a higher calling of the church, and that is to focus solely on Him. I feel that in this hour, we can look to the things of the world and we can say, God, that's not good. But the only way that they will listen to us is not because we believe in them. It's because they see a holiness upon the church. They see a church that says, listen, I maybe have created some things, but I need to repent for the things that I created in and of myself. I need to do those things under you so that you can put your hands on and do what you want to do. That's what burns us to get to the table in the world. Not because we think that what they're doing is truly good, and we'll probably kill them. It doesn't resonate. But the love of the Father coming through His children to the community is all that matters. Do you guys hear what the Spirit says to the churches? To him who overcomes, I will give. Of his So not only were they facing exclusion from community, society, they were facing the real threat of death every single day because they did not come in to the one that they were born in.
I
deceived. You can stand in an auditorium and you can have all the flowers, you can have all the lights, you can have all the stuff, but really you're not there for all that. You're there for the one thing. And Jesus, before you ever knew anything about him or any goodness that he has, he was there for you. So maybe you're here this time this morning and you've been producing and producing and producing and he's watching you. And today's the day to come forward, repent, and make your focus in. Maybe you're in the room today and you've been a good church builder for a long time, but you haven't ever met Jesus. That was him. That was him. I went to church for a long time, but I never met him. I just knew that wrong about him. He doesn't want to marry someone who knows a lot about him. He wants to marry someone, the church. He wants to marry the church who doesn't just know a lot about him. In fact, he would probably want us to learn less about him and more about his presence there. You see, sometimes I think we read the scripture and we put these people on pedestals because it's people like you and I who knew him. Who knew him. The power came from knowing him. So if you're here this morning, you've done the work, and you're doing the work, but you haven't surrendered to him, you haven't repented to him. If you're here and you have never walked that way, and you don't even know how to create something with him, that is how the power gets him into this view of him. And if you're, if you put the tag on that you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you look around the world and the world has to be in chaos because it's still belongs to you. sacrifice all that he was to come out. I believe he's looking for a generation, he's looking for a church in Coburn, Ohio, he's looking for a church that says, listen, we're not going to build a bunch of things. We're going to focus on the one thing. So this is an old chorus. seeing us in our brokenness too. To seeing the potential that you have called us to that's written in our book. Jesus, we are focused always on you.
I'm going to go to the next one.
going to be looking at the world and saying, why are the problems that have done it before? Why have they done it first for you and never before? And you can see that there's a part of the Father who is enlightened today. And a protection of the anointing of heaven. So, Father, today we feel this moment. Thank you.